Okay, my name is Ron Carrico with the San Diego Air and Space Museum. Today is October the 10th, 2016. I'm with Christian Scharff, who's the one of the sons of Hanns Scharff, who was an interrogator for the Luftwaffe in 1943 through 1945. He was known as the Master Interrogator. He was the he developed and helped shape some U.S. Interrogation techniques after the war. He only interviewed fighter pilots with the 8th Air Force. Not the 9th Air Force as well, just the 8th?
Just the 8th.
And we're going to talk about first who Hanns Scharff was, and then we're going to talk about his interrogation techniques. And then after that, I think we're going to talk about what you did during the war as a child and time after that. So, your father was born in 1907. He passed in 1992, and he lived in California at the end of his life, correct?
Yep.
How did he develop to be an interrogator for the Luftwaffe? Maybe you can tell us the story.
We all wanted to know how that happened. as a young man, he wanted to become an architect. His father had passed away in the First World War, and his grandfather was bringing him up in the town of Greiz, which is in southeast Germany in Thuringen. And
I'm gonna put it closer.
My dad wanted to, as I said, he wanted to become an architect. And then, of course, his grandfather, who was a factory owner and a very wealthy man, said, "You don't want to be an architect. If you need an architect, we hire one." So he went anyway. He went to university and he took an arts major, and he liked art. Then at the end of his schooling, he decided he wanted to get into business and trade, and I don't know too much about the little details of that, but he ended up in South Africa opening up a car business for Adler Auto Works and imported cars into South Africa. And while doing that, you know, he met my mother, married, had a child who was born in South Africa, Johannesburg, my brother. And I'm not sure, but probably once a year he'd travel back to Germany, see the home company, do business with them, talk about, I guess, planning his new shipments and stuff like that. And during one of those trips, I was born. And we went back to South Africa, and I lived in South Africa until I was 3. And we went back and did another trip, and that was in 1939. And when he wanted to leave, and it was time to go back to South Africa, they said, "Nuh-uh, there's going to be a war." So he was stuck.
And where was he living at that time?
I remember as about being about 3, 3 and a half, living in the town of Greiz.
Was this a large house?
No, we lived in an apartment which my grandfather owned. He owned a lot of property there. And I lived with my grandmother. My great-grandfather owned a lot of property. And we lived in a town, in the town of Greiz. For a while, then we went to Berlin and lived in Berlin, I guess, until 43, when my dad was drafted. Up until that time, he'd remained in business.
So let's see. So he was born in 1907. So he was at that time, and he would have been 30 odd years old, somewhere in that area, 32,
yeah,
33.
Whatever. Yeah. So, my brother, my mother, and I, and my dad lived in forgotten the name of the town, very close to the hotel, or the city hall where Kennedy stood on the steps and said, "Ich bin ein Berliner." If you remember that, mm-hmm. I'm a Berliner.
Who could forget?
And we lived on a street called Martin Luther Strasse, which ran right by that hotel. Anyway, so we lived there, and I remember the first air raids, and which were the British night bombers. Then he got drafted, and I guess what happened when he got drafted, we left and went back to his grandfather's villa, which was the factory owner and the guy who owned a lot of property in the town of Greiz. And we stayed in the villa, which my grandmother was living there, my uncle was living there, my great-grandfather was living there. He died, I'm not sure, but I think he died shortly after we got there. And so we spent the rest of the war in Greiz, while my dad was in the drafted. He did get, and it's in the book as well, it tells the story how he was drafted to, as a foot soldier, to go to the Russian front with it.
He was actually involved in the interrogations.
No, I mean, we go back to where he was drafted in the army, and he was going to work, be a foot soldier with a tank corps going to the Russian front.
Right.
And my mother thought that was kind of stupid.
Since he spoke English.
Since he was fluent in English.
Right.
And so she went to his commanding officer and she said, what the hell? As an English woman, she went to the commanding officer and said, what are you doing? You're sending a guy who's fluent in English to the Russian front, and his whole regiment was embarking on the train, and they said, come, we got a different assignment for you. She saved his life. And he went and was sent to as an interpreter. He started out as an interpreter, and working at, I think, Oberursel at the time. Mm-hmm. And then there was an accident, and one of the interrogators got killed in a little plane accident. And they said, well, you better go and start doing that. I don't think he had much formal training in the whole thing, interrogation or anything. From what, everything I've said, I've known, he never said that he went to a formal school of interrogation.
Well, at that time, by the Geneva Conventions, with the Germans and the Americans, probably tried to at least adhere to, the prisoner was supposed to be treated with respect, properly fed, not have to work for the officers at least, and also were required only to give their name, rank, and serial number. But of course, the idea of interrogation is to learn more. Out of them. Apparently, your father studied what other people did and came up with his own.
I mean, yeah, and I've met a lot of his POWs and chatted with them, and one of them used to be share our table with John at our Wednesday breakfast.
Yeah,
and he, you know,
let me state what that is. It's the breakfast you're talking about is the old Bold Pilots organization,
yeah.
Which meets.
We have, and in that group we have, or had, two German fighter pilots, one ME-109 fighter pilot, one 262, ME-262 night fighter jet pilot. Dulagluft stood for Durchgangslager, which means through camp, pass-through camp, which was the interrogation camp.
Yeah.
Which was at
I wonder how many people he interrogated.
Don't know, a lot.
Be hundreds.
Yeah. I mean, they were coming fast and furious.
Yeah, well, I heard when I talked.
How my dad, one thing I can tell you as a son of his and having lived with him, he's a showman. And he's a very intelligent guy, and he's very historically oriented. He can remember stuff. And so he'd like to fool around with people, make them really comfortable and at ease. I remember as a kid in living in Berlin when I was really probably only 4 years old, I remember he used to have parties and he'd like to do magic tricks. You know, he was a little amateur magician and stuff. That was his style. And so I think he just naturally employed that kind of a technique with people, being very friendly and chatting to them. And he learned stuff as he went along. There was a protocol. Most fighter pilots were put in the cooler a couple of days, you know, 30 days max, no longer. And then they'd haul them out. By then they sort of hope everybody's a little softened up and anxious to get the hell out of there. And he'd bring them in and start speaking to them. Go ahead.
It's okay, but the first thing they did is before they were sent to a regular prisoner of war camp.
They went to Oberursel, which is where my dad was.
Which was called a
Durchgangslager.
What is a
through processing.
Sweet processing.
Through processing.
Okay.
Camp, which is where the interrogation was. Once the interrogation was over, and I think they could only hold them so many days, then they went to a permanent, like Stalag Luft 3, and a permanent POW camp. I guess it's the trick of making them believe you know everything. Kind of like, don't ask a question that you don't know the answer to, but you will then get another answer of something else that is of value to you.
Yeah, yeah.
And the police use the same techniques. Yeah.
Started with being friendly.
Absolutely. Absolutely. He could. Let me give you an example. A fighter pilot I knew, P-51 pilot, just lived very close to me here, Norm Aiken. He got shot down. He was captured. He was stuck in the cooler for 30 days or X a number of days. And then he was brought to my dad, and the orderly brings him in. He says, this is Hanns Scharff, he's your interrogator. And the first thing my dad said to him, with a stern face, his name, remember, was Norman Aiken, Aachen, which is a city in Germany. And my dad said to him, tell me, why are you fighting the fatherland? And Norm said to me, he told me, he said, God, I didn't know what I was in for. This could have been a kangaroo court. I don't know. I had no idea. So I just did the standard thing, rank, name, and serial number. And my dad said, forget all that stuff. That's nonsense. You know? He said, the real problem with you is that you're being accused of having shot civilians. And if that's proven, you'll be executed for shooting civilians, strafing civilians. Now Norm really thought, I'm in trouble. And it was a turning point in his life.
Well,
it really was.
Let's point out
these P-47s and P-51s.
Yeah, I think that primarily they were the ground attack patent artillery, some people call them.
So. Yeah. Anyway, so Norm said, I did not. We said, well, how can you prove it? He said, look at my gun cameras. Just take a look at my gun cameras. You can see that I never shot at anybody. My dad said, this was all from Norm, the American pilot. He said that my dad said, you know, so you see the civilians, you shoot, you turn off your camera and you go and shoot them. And he says, can't do that. When you arm your cannons or your machine guns, your camera's automatically gone. They're not independent. It is automatic. It's part of the system. He said, really? Okay. Well, your gun cameras are on the way to Berlin to be developed. But in the meantime, let me just get on the phone here. And my dad picked up the phone. And he said, put me through to the hospital. Yeah, I want to talk to Snuffy Smith. And Norm says, Snuffy Smith was my squadron commander. what the hell is he talking about? This is all nonsense. And my dad says, oh, hello, Snuffy. I got one of your boys here, Norm Aiken. He says that you can't turn on your cannons or your machine guns without putting on the cameras. He said, oh, is that right? Well, you just saved your boy's life. And he turned around to Norm Aiken and said, here, you want to talk to your squadron commander? And Norm said, this is just silly, because I know he's got a broad Texas accent and everything, you know. He picks up the phone and he says, Lieutenant Norm Aiken here. And there comes a, hi, so they finally got you, all in a big, broad accent, Texas accent. And it was the squadron commander. So my dad takes the phone away and he says, we're going to dinner tonight. And he brought the guy from the hospital and Norm Aiken, they all went to dinner and they chatted. And that's how he got in with people and broke them down quietly and in a totally different way. But there's much more. There's much more behind his total interrogation technique. There's a whole huge organization of information gathering, people, you know, who bring information from spies, you name it, whatever. And my dad used to say, I'm actually sitting in the middle of the spider web, and all the information comes down through the peripheral from the spider web into me, and he can check everything. And he checked everything. He had newspapers coming from Spain, New York Times. He had information coming from England, from spies, no doubt, you know, and whatever it was, wherever he could get it. There were radio towers that were listening in to the fighter pilots and the bombers as they were flying in, so he'd catch all their chatter, and they were all English-speaking guys, and they'd listen to the chatter, and it would still come in to my dad, so he could put pictures together.
So part of his technique was to convince people
that he knew everything.
That he knew it. Basically, then try and get some elicit some information that the person probably thought he knew anyway.
Yeah. Another example of one thing that he learned, crazy. He was expecting a POW to come in for interrogation, and he had all his files laid out on the table of various guys he was interrogating, and they brought the prisoner in a little bit early, and he was kind of surprised. And there was no time for him to shuffle up and pick up all his papers. And the POW, the pilot, comes, walks in, looks at the table, goes around, picks up his folder, gives it to my dad. He thought that was the procedure. So afterwards, that's what my dad did, you know. And by that time, they already thought, well, they know so much about me, you know. For one of the pilots, he had... there was a nice picture of his, I don't know whether it was a P-51 or not, in the New York Times, which he got from Spain. And he really liked that picture. It was a great photograph. And he had it blown up. It's a big photograph put behind his desk.
Was that Gabreski?
I don't think it was Gabreski, no. No, it wasn't Gabreski. Anyway, so the POW comes in, and he looks up and sees the plane behind him. He says, oh, this breaks my heart. In other words, you already know my plane. What are you going to interrogate me about? You know, a lot of stuff like that. And so I think my dad learned a lot as he went along. And
what kind of things did he actually learn? Did he ever tell you of anything he learned?
Just things like I just told you with the folder, using that. Using all the information he could gather, using stuff that a lot of stuff, like he'd find that prisoners would have their escape documents. They'd take all their escape documents and they'd find out that guys from a certain squadron, they had escape document in civilian clothes so that they could maybe escape and look like civilians and have German papers. But he noticed that a lot of them would wear the same tie. When they were being photographed with their escape documents, depending on where it was, they'd say to the guy, here, put on a tie and jacket, and photograph him. Then the next guy put on a tie and jacket. And he found out that these guys from this particular area had the same, all were wearing the same tie. And once he figured out who one of them was, the guy would walk in and he'd say, oh, you're from such and such, right? Because he recognized already the tie and the jacket. Silly little things like that. Silly little things.
It is funny that they had documents to sort of pretend that they were, I guess, Germans or French or laborers or something like that, with those silly pictures with the same tie on, rather than just admitting that they were U.S. Army Air Corps aviator. I don't know why they just didn't.
Well, a lot of them, some escaped. Yeah. Never were captured.
Yeah.
You know, and they made it back to friendly lines. And I mean, there were resistance people all over the place to help them. And it depends on where they were shot down. If they were shot down, say, in France or something like that, there was a lot of resistance to help them.
Now, didn't I read that he had pictures of, like, Betty Grable on the wall or things like that?
That I don't know. I don't think so. Not that he never mentioned it.
Yeah, I just thought that I read that he had. We really wanted to make people comfortable. Have a cigarette.
No question about that. Yeah. I mean, yeah.
And he was, in essence, trying to convince them that he's their protector. Otherwise, they're going to be sent to a labor camp or shot or whatever.
No, he never. And you know, when I came here in 65, he was already deeply involved in his business, which was mosaic art, doing mosaic art.
He would have been 58 at the time.
Probably, yeah. Yeah. So he didn't talk much. We didn't talk much about it, but it would crop up in conversations.
Yeah. He took people for walks in the woods.
Yes.
Nearby.
Yep. Like I said, Norm Aiken and his boss, he took him to dinner that night. He did. He did mention that he had to have a Gestapo guy present,
right,
who kind of kept an eye on things. In fact, my dad was at one time accused of being too friendly by the Gestapo, and they didn't like that.
Yep.
But he proved that he was worthy of what he did. Look, one guy, Lieutenant Malmstrom, was shot down, and when he was talking to my dad, he said, boy, I'll tell you, that ME-109, that's a hell of a plane. That really gave me trouble. I'd love to be able to fly one of those. My dad called up the local air station, said, you got an ME-109? Put a couple of gallons of gas in it, I'm going to have an American fly it. Took him down there, let the guy get in the plane, fly it around. He knew he couldn't go anywhere. Did a couple of circles, whatever he did, landed the plane, and he was just so excited. He was jabbering about all kinds of stuff, and and I think he was the guy who said, you know, one of the orders my dad had was to find out what is it when the American fighter pilot, when the Americans shoot a steady stream of tracer bullets, what does that mean? Find out. And Malmstrom let him know because he was so excited about the flight. I think that was the guy. He said, damn, if I'd known that so-and-so, when I ran out of ammo and I saw this, my solid stream of tracer bullets, I should have just blah, 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 whatever the conversation was, but my dad picked up on it. And there was some valuable information from the German point of view.
So now, there was a famous defector, Martin Monti, Lieutenant.
Yes.
Martin Monti. Your father interviewed him. Did he ever talk about that?
No, not really. He just said that at the end of the war, he had to go to, he came to New York as a prosecution witness.
But he also testified on behalf of some pilots.
That's correct. The State Department, I think, wanted to prosecute more than just Monty because they knew that a lot of information had been passed on to my dad. And he said, look, they couldn't help it. Here's why not. This is how I dealt with it, you know. I'd take somebody out, we'd go and have ice cream or go to a movie house, and we'd just be chatting. And little stuff would slip out, you know, and blah, blah, blah. And so he'd talk about it, and he said, eventually, he basically became a defense witness for those other pilots, you know, who they're trying to prosecute.
So that was at about 1947, 48.
48, I think he came out, yeah. He turned himself in to the Americans when they knew the war was over. The Americans sent him back to Eastern Zone, said, where are you guys from? Because their prison, POW camp was just packed. They couldn't handle the people. They said, all the guys who come from this part of Germany, stand up or put your hand up. And he was one of them, came from what became East Germany. And they said, get on the train. They put him on a train, sent them back east, said, get out there, wherever. And like I said, it was east of Frankfurt. And they got out the train, and he turned right around and walked back in again to the, what ended up being a Western Zone. And eventually got worked in the POW camp, tanking up, pumping gas for the guys, you know, and then they started looking for him because they heard about him, they found him, and that's where he then started traveling.
Well, so now, okay, the end of the war comes and it's May 1945, and you were...
We were, at the end of the war, we were in Greiz, in the hometown. And in the meantime, some part of Patton's army, as it was passing through there on the way to Czechoslovakia, remember they went to Czechoslovakia, they billeted my great-grandfather's villa, where we were living. It was a pretty big place. And they billeted that, kicked us out, we went down to the factory and lived in the offices for a while. And when they withdrew, when there was time for the Americans to withdraw from the Eastern Zone and turn it over to the Russians, they said to my mother, obviously an English-speaking woman, not with an accent, she was an English person, they said, you know, if you want to get away from the Russians, we'll take you out. So we'd actually got onto the trucks with the American soldiers, my mother and five kids.
So you were 10 at that time?
9.
But you really remember this really well then, don't you?
I remember a lot of stuff. Yeah. I remember a lot of stuff.
Yeah.
I mean, I remember doing all the bad things that kids do to those poor American soldiers who were living in the villa, stealing them blind.
Really?
Oh, yeah. Shit. I did a lot of bad things. Well, my brother and I,
they must have been pretty intimidating, though, at the time. I mean, here they were armed soldiers and not that much older than you,
no,
actually.
No, they weren't intimidating at all. They were terribly nice guys.
Really?
We'd go into the villa, we'd walk in there, and the guys would say, and we could speak English, too, because we spoke English and German all the time. And the soldiers would say, hey, throw a box in the room, and come on, give them some candy, give them some of this, give them that. And we'd pick up that stuff and go out and have candy, and then we'd steal their ammunition if we could when they weren't looking, or whatever the hell we could lay our hands on, bayonets, anything.
Well, when was it that the Americans got there to Greiz?
Had to have been probably early part of 45.
Well, they liberated some of
the... I don't know. I mean, I as a kid, I didn't have a calendar, and I didn't know how to read a calendar.
Springtime, probably.
Probably, somewhere in spring. Yeah, it wasn't winter.
Yeah, because they liberated the big camp down at south of Munich, Duisburg, in January 29th, 45.
Yeah.
And I, you know, talked to guys that were prisoners there, and they said after a week or so they were starving again because they'd just run out of food, and one guy just escaped. You know, they were told to stay there, and he said, deck with this, I'm out of here.
Yeah.
And he just walked all the way back to Paris. Yeah. And then the other guy, Ralph Kling, he said he went, and him and another guy, they also escaped and went north up to, can't remember the name of the town, where he knew his squadron was. That he'd been shot down in September, so he went up to his squadron and looked up his best friend. He said, "I got to fly one more time. Let's go over to get in the P-47. And the other guy was a little bit, "Let me sit. I'll fly. You sit in my lap." And they taxied out, and I guess the squadron commander got wind of what was going on, and I guess he called and said, "Is Kling with you? Better don't pull back in, or I'll court-martial you." So.
What we did see as kids, we saw the destitute crowds, refugees moving west in front of the Russian, approaching Russians.
So I wondered about
that.
And
they moved through our town, and they were just...
So where had they gone? Had they just escaped Germany to get east, to get the heck out of, away from the...
Well, the Russians were advancing from Czechoslovakia and that whole broad front. And any Germans in any area in ahead of the Russians, they were told the Russians were terrible, and they were. I mean, they did everything that they could.
Why are the Russians so terrible? I don't understand.
I don't know. So, I mean, different breed. Anyway, I guess the Germans didn't treat them too well either. But we saw the German civilians, horse carts, dog carts, old automobiles, anything stacked, piled high, just trying to escape the Russians. They may have made it to the eastern, to the western zone. I'm sure a lot of them didn't, and got trapped.
Well, Greitz is in...
That was Thuringen. It's in Thuringen.
There was a Prussia at the time, right?
No.
No?
Prussia was basically... Well, East Prussia is where my dad was born, which was part of Poland now.
So where was Greitz in relationship to Berlin?
South. So, Berlin, Dresden,
right.
Greitz, Chemnitz, Frankfurt.
Okay. So,
and we were really not far from the Sudetenland, which was that point of Czechoslovakia that stuck into Germany.
That Hitler took over in 1938.
Right.
Or something like that.
That was one of his first,
his
early moves. So anyway, we left with the American soldiers. They dumped us after a couple of days on some railway station, which we found out later, my dad was in the same town. We didn't know that. But then we got onto a flat car, and for 2 weeks we dragged our way in this train to some other part of Germany, or eventually ended up in Belgium. No food, no water. One of the American soldiers gave my mom a bottle of what he was called chlor pills. They were actually chlorine pills. And he said, "Don't you drink any water, don't touch any water unless you have it standing with a couple of these pills in it first." We had two wicker baskets with all our clothing, and I guess she had a pot.
She had a what?
A pot.
Oh.
For water.
Yeah.
And we were in a flat car, not an open car, not a closed car, it's just a flatbed cattle truck, or not even a cattle truck. And she'd jump off the train every now and again, grab some fruit in any orchard we passed through, or get some water and stuff like that. And eventually we went into some camp run by British, and we were deloused, standard procedure, DDT.
Yeah.
And then from there we were moved to another DP camp, which was in Belgium. And I'm not sure if it was close to Brussels or not, but it was right on a big forest. It was also kind of a villa.
Ardennes Forest.
I don't know if it was the Ardennes Forest or not. There were a lot of paths through it, with Quonset huts that had ammunition in it, because my brother and I found out how to break open the ammunition, get the cordite out, and light it, and play around with it, and do stuff. But
young boys, huh?
Oh yeah, we were hellions, and my mother was occupied with my youngest brother, who was two or two and a half, and my sister, who was probably 4 and a half, and she had her hands full, and we kind of ran amok.
So what was the condition? Do you remember vividly what the towns were like? Were they much flat?
When we traveled on those 2 weeks in the flat car, we went through just absolutely devastated country. Flattened towns, just skeletons of pieces of brick buildings sticking up, holes in the hills, trees knocked down, and the train just crawled along slowly. I mean, that's all it could do.
What was it? You must have memories of bombing raids in the area.
The first bombing raid was when we were living in Berlin, and the British bombers came at night. I remember my dad took us out onto our veranda and said, look, there's the bomber, see the searchlights, they had him pinned. And you could hear the AK-AK guns trying to get him. They never got him, but they were shooting. That was the first, we'd hear some bombs.
That was the first raid.
The very first that I remember. And we were going to school in Berlin, my brother and I. Then we had some more raids before my dad was drafted. And I remember going to school, and in our neighborhood, we walked around the corner and the buildings were just gone. They were just walls. Every floor had collapsed on itself. And I guess there was incendiary bombs, because we could smell wood. Everything had been burnt. And that was, after that, I don't remember much because we left. I do remember we had an empty lot next to our apartment, and my brother and I had two little boys who were our friends we used to play with, and played with them just about every day. And one day they came out and they had on their jackets they had the Star of David. And we said, "What's that? Why have you got that on your jacket?" We didn't know what it was. They said, "Oh, we just have to have it on." Didn't worry about it. Nobody worried about it. 2 days, 3 days, or maybe a week later, they were gone. We never saw them again. So you know what happened to them. And then we went back to my great-grandfather's place in Greiz from Berlin. And towards the end of the war, we did see bombing raids. They'd actually come maybe 1,000 bombers. Sometimes you could see them. Most of the time you couldn't. You'd just see the contrails. And the harmonics of those 1,000 bombers, or however many bombers it was, the house would shake before they became visible. And everything would just vibrate in the house, you know. The house would go, and glasses would rattle and whatnot. And then they'd come almost pretty much every day. They came right over our little town of Greiz. We'd see them up there, we'd see a flare, and they'd split. And one would go, what we thought was towards Chemnitz, do some bombing there, and the other would hang a right and go down to Frankfurt or Plauen. And sometimes we could hear bombs falling, but they never bombed our village. This was just a little industrial textile town. So
hard to imagine, isn't it?
Well,
I mean, maybe not for you, but to me, it's just hard to imagine anything that horrible. I guess if you lived in Afghanistan or Iraq right now, you probably wouldn't think that.
We didn't have it anywhere near as bad as that. Nothing near as bad. But I'm sure people in Berlin and Dresden and places like that, yeah, they went through the same stuff. Yeah. Worse.
Dresden, for sure.
We left Dresden a half hour before the big firebomb thing. My dad had some business family business associates who were there in Dresden.
Oh, so you were with him?
We were with him.
So you saw him sometimes during the...
Yes, yes, he'd come to the house. He'd say, you know, get furlough and whatnot. And sometimes he'd dash off and say... Actually, it was the family jeweler who'd been family jeweler for, I don't know, 100 years, his family. We went out to see them, and we got on the train, and we heard when we arrived back to Graz, we heard that they firebombed the place. And just people were running in the streets, and it was so hot they just shriveled up and died. Yeah. War is ugly. War is ugly.
Well, especially, I mean, that was in April of 45, I believe, and it was really late in the war. It was almost unnecessary.
Yeah. Oh, it was unnecessary. It was a vengeance attack.
Well, the British were really big on bombing cities. I know that.
No, you can't blame them. I mean, the Germans, you V1'd them and V2'd them and bombed them. But that was Eisenhower, as far as I know. That was his plan, to go and bomb Dresden.
Was it really?
That was a punishment raid for being Germans. And you think about it, it's strange when you... I've been on the receiving end to some extent. I mean, I've seen a lot of what happens during war. And I remember it vividly, you know, driving the flat cart cattle trucks through cities just totally smashed, and people who just civilians died by the thousands, tens of thousands. And now we worry about, you know, in these wars with ISIS where they go and chop off people's heads and stuff, and we worry about killing one or two civilians, collateral damage. You know, you can't avoid collateral damage if you're going to... That's, you know, think about that Second World War. Think about what we did to Japan. We are, now I'm an American, right? What we did to Japan. Just obliterated them. To stop the war. And now we try to be so politically correct and try to do everything the right way. But it doesn't really work that way. War is war is war. That's it. And it's ugly, and it should never come to war.
You know, you kind of wonder if there is any way to look back at what happened there and anyway compare it to what's happened in the Middle East.
I don't know. I've often thought about it. I once a newspaper guy interviewed me and said, what do you think, you know, how do you think that would have worked in the Middle East? And I wasn't sure. I felt that we were two different types of societies. That the European society, which was fighting itself, had different mores and values than they do over there. And I didn't think it would work. I didn't know that it would, that my dad's techniques of interrogation would work under with those kind of people. And I went to Warner Springs. You familiar with Warner Springs?
Mm-hmm.
I went up to Warner Springs with a guy called Fred Ferrazzano, who was in the Naval Intelligence. He said, we're going to tour that place. And the guys were very excited when they met the Scharff. And they said, you know, let me take you to the what we call the Hanns Scharff soft cell room. And they had a little room down there at Warner Springs.
Oh, wait, hold on. I'm thinking of Warner Springs as being a vacation facility, but they have
they have a survival camp.
They have a survival camp.
A SEER camp, right.
Yeah. Yeah, exactly.
And that's where we went.
Wow.
And I toured it with Fred, and the guys were excited. Oh, we know all about Hanns Scharff. And then they told me about survival and this and that, and how they learn to use both types of techniques of interrogation. And then I read a long article in the LA Times about when we first went to Afghanistan, how they had interrogators use there was a team of interrogators, and the head interrogator said, nobody is going to be a bona fide interrogator working on interrogating Taliban or whoever they were unless they've read the book Hanns Scharff, The Interrogator.
Okay.
Yeah. And they were actually mostly accountants. And they said accountants make excellent interrogators because they really watch after the pennies. So they pick up on small things. Okay. And there was a woman who was interrogating. I thought, that's kind of strange for a woman to be interrogating men who despise women.
Can't even imagine that.
Well, she had, and I don't know the names, but let's say Ali, okay? She went in every day. She'd go into his cell, say, good morning, Ali, how are you? And he knew so-and-so. It wasn't going to give anything. He didn't say anything. Good morning, blah, blah, blah. And it just ended up, and then she'd leave again. And then she got some information, just like my dad did, from outside, saying that Ali's name was actually, let's say, Muhammad, and that he had, that was his name. And she walked in one morning, same smile on her face, and said, good morning, Muhammad. And he said, oh, shit, he just started spilling the beans, because he figured she knew everything anyway, if she knew his name. And she learned a lot of stuff that she'd never heard before. And it was good intelligence. So you can see how the technique works. You know, you always say, you always wonder yourself, if you imagine yourself being interrogated and there's a threat of torture, and you apply it visually to yourself, you say, well, I would tell them, yes, I would tell them. But my dad always said, the information is unreliable because you don't know what he's saying just to avoid torture. But if you're in a conversation with somebody and he's not being heard, and he begins to speak and tell you stuff, you know it's more valuable than it is if it's under duress. But yet, you know that we all think that torture is going to bring the real truth out. You know that Sheikh Khalid, whatever, SHK or whatever they call
KSM.
It. KSM. He divulged some information, but he didn't divulge it through waterboarding. Did you know that?
That doesn't surprise me at all.
Waterboarding didn't bother him at all because he knew they'd keep him alive.
Yeah.
What did eventually break him was hunger.
Was what?
Hunger and lack of sleep. That's what I read anyway.
Yeah. I just wonder how much information they actually get out of those guys. Because most people are foot soldiers. And they don't know much. I mean, sure. But did you ever meet Gabby Grabowski?
Yeah.
You did. Where'd you meet him?
My dad's house.
At your dad's house. He did.
I met Gabby Grabowski. I met the head of the wolf pack. God, I can't remember any of their names.
Zimke.
Hub Zimke.
Right.
Yeah, I met him. I met the guy who didn't get captured in Germany and then flew in Korea and was shot down and tortured by the Koreans. And when he finally came home, he said, your book of survival, Hanns Scharff, didn't work with the Koreans.
Yeah.
You know, they're totally different people, totally different mindset. You know, and torture was a big thing.
Where did your dad live?
Hollywood Hills.
And then he moved down to Tehachapi, didn't he?
He had a house in Tehachapi and a house in Hollywood Hills or Laurel Canyon. Then
So your father, when he got out of the when he came to the United States, he opened up his business.
He for a while he worked in Chicago, and I'm not sure of the timing, but eventually he went back to New York and started a mosaic business, which was his love. And he got a couple of good contracts with the Neiman Marcus in Texas. And then he figured out, you know, New York is not the place. He had a fourth floor walk-up apartment and a shop. He said, I got to get out of here. So he left and came here to California. Just settled in and started a business and went to tile manufacturers, you know, tile distributors, and said, this is my work, this is what I can do, and became very successful. Worked for Disney, did Disney World, did stuff all over for the city of L.A., everywhere, churches. I know that the CIA and the FBI have adopted my dad's method of interrogation. And the Denmark has and Sweden has. And that's I think, that's how they interrogate. So it's kind of interesting. He, you know, it was the book, Ray Tolliver's book, that brought my dad to fame and the internet. I don't know if you've ever Googled Scharff, Hanns Scharff. Do it. You'll find a lot of stuff.
No, I forgot. I read the Wikipedia. There's okay. 6 or 7 pages of Wikipedia.
Yeah. My brother had to correct some stuff in it. It wasn't right. We don't know who wrote the original Wikipedia article. But he certainly rose to fame because of the book and the internet together.
Yeah. So you were fortunate enough to get together with your father at the time when these heroes from World War II on both sides were still alive, and
yep.
Your father would entertain them in his house.
Yeah.
Wow.
I also met Günter Rahl, if you know the name.
Didn't he live around here somewhere?
No. He used to come and visit. And he became the head of NATO Air Force.
Right.
And he purchased the Starfighter for NATO.
Right.
And so he went around with a guy, Lute Eldridge, who was an American pilot.
Mm-hmm.
And Lute Eldridge and Freddy Farizano, the naval intelligence guy, who was also a Navy pilot, and Ray Tolliver and Kurt Schultz and I used to sit at the same table for breakfast. And
in the old vaults up here?
Yeah, in the old vault, yeah. And very interesting. I mean, and then Günter Rahl would come and visit Lute and stay with him for a couple of weeks. And I met Günter the first time I met him. I said, did you know my father? He said, I know very well of him, but I didn't know him in Germany. All I did was I used to send him customers.
Yeah, I've seen it. Günter Rahl has been in our museum several times.
He's a great guy. Wonderful gentleman. He passed away a couple years ago.
Yeah.
And I met Adolf Galland. I met him. I met a couple guys, quite a few of them.
So your father loved to entertain, and so yes. When these people would come to California, he would invite them down.
Oh, yeah. And his 70th birthday, 75th birthday, I can't remember which, he brought out Gabby Gabreski from New York and his son, who was also at that time was a major in the Air Force.
Right.
I don't know where he is now. And my wife and I and Gabreski, Don Gabreski, we went skiing up in Mammoth and stuff like that. So,
well,
we got to know each other pretty well. Dulagluft stood for Durchgangslager, which means through camp, pass-through camp, which was the interrogation camp.
Yeah.
Which was at
I wonder how many people he interrogated.
I don't know, a lot.
It'd be hundreds.
Yeah. I mean, they were coming.
No
interrogating
one.
Them, the techniques my dad has seems to work still. Even though they may expect something else, you know, like torture and beheadings or fingernails cut up and stuff
yeah.
like that. But they seem to respond to, as I related to the lady interrogator in Afghanistan, of a Muslim, you know.
Yeah.
And it worked. So
yeah. Well, if you can, you know, if you balance being tortured to death, not tortured, and it seems like they already know everything anyway.
Yeah.
Why not?
It's, I guess it's the trick of making them believe you know everything. Kind of like, don't ask a question that you don't know the answer to, but you will then get another answer of something else that is of value to you.
Yeah, yeah.
And the police use the same techniques. Yeah. But the concept of torture is a very popular one, very popular.
I know, it's...
I feel, personally, if somebody's going to start, you know, putting electrical wires on me and doing stuff like that, I tell them anything they want, and that's exactly what my dad says. Yeah. They'll tell you anything you want, and more.
Ray Tolliver, who is the historian for the U.S. Fighter Aces Association and a prolific author, searched for Hanns all over the world for a period of 20 years to find out finally that he lived only a few miles away in the Los Angeles area. Ray Tolliver wrote the book, The Interrogator, and that the book brought to the attention of the United States the fact that the true facts of how American prisoners were treated by the Luftwaffe, and that contrary to Errol Flynn's experience, they were treated humanely and in accordance with the laws of the Geneva Convention. The book also brought Hanns Scharff into the public light, and he has lectured at the Smithsonian, the Air Force Museum Foundation, Soldier Fortune Convention, and of course here with us tonight. Ladies and gentlemen, The Interrogator, Hanns Scharff.
Thank you, Mike. Mr. Commandant, sir, distinguished guests, and ladies and gentlemen, tonight we are discussing a problem every soldier who falls into enemy hands faces, whether he may or may not give the enemy any information. Of course, he may not give him any information because he is under orders to say nothing to the enemy but his rank, his name, and his number. This rule has been modified a little bit by President Eisenhower. When General Eisenhower became president, it was modified a little, but it still stays on the same principle, rank, name, and number, period. I have to give you no more. If a soldier gives the enemy more information, he may be regarded as a traitor. A traitor loses his military honor. He may be discharged dishonorably for having become a traitor. On the other hand, the enemy seeks from him information, and he uses every trick in the world, deception, skill, preparation, beforehand preparation, to get out of the prisoner the answers he needs to know. And I will give you some examples tonight in my talk how this is done. I, as an interrogation officer in the rank of private first class, met the top fighter aces of the United States. It was debatable whether the competition between the different fighter groups was of great value, because they were so eager to score victories to become aces that they finally all ended up in my lap. It is very difficult for you to understand the very intricate workings of an intelligence center. I will give you some examples, but it would take me hours to explain to you in detail how the intricate work of 18 different departments' works of an intelligence center. There is a good description of Ray Tolliver's in the Interrogator, and Mike was good enough to ship in some of the books. In case you want one, I will be very glad to autograph it for you. I had at my command 18 different departments, which were the tools I worked with. And whenever a prisoner was brought to me, I used these tools, and I shall explain to you how I did it. I will tell you the truth, and you can question me if you wish. If you have any question on your mind, I will answer you. The basic problem to begin with was to establish an identity of a prisoner of war, because anybody could, even a spy, pose as a flyer and come into our camp and snoop around as a spy. Therefore, we made sure that a prisoner was whom he claimed he was. At my guest book, which is on display at the Air Force Museum in Dayton, Ohio, is one page which describes that identification business very well. And when I question people, I take, for example, a very famous American ace, Captain Kenneth Smith from Boise, Idaho, who fell into my lap. I said, "Who are you?" He said, "Captain Smith." He said, "Anybody can say that. How do you want to prove? Tell me." He was an Eagle Squadron American who had served first in the Royal Air Force, then in the famous 4th Fighter Group. And he said, "Captain Smith, my number is so-and-so." And I said, "Anybody can say that." And every American then would say, "How do you want to prove it?" They would pull out their dog tag and say, "Here's my dog tag to prove it." That dog tag business annoyed me so much that, and I will tell you later on what I printed on my dog tag. I had an exactly American dog tag made up, and when Captain Smith said to me, "Here's my dog tag to prove that I'm Captain Smith," I said, "Well, and here is my dog tag to prove to you that I am Colonel Bullshit." He wrote that into my guest book, and that's on display at the Air Force Museum. Ladies, forgive me the harsh soldier's language. There will come up some more. But this is the way I showed them that I was not satisfied with just that. Here is my dog tag to prove who I am. And it, that dog tag of mine made a lot of sense. The departments I wish to describe to you are, the number one, of course, is the so-called cooler. We adopted the British word, the English word, cooler, because the German word Kriegsgefangengefängnis is much too long. And that cooler had 250 single cells in which every incoming prisoner was locked up. Now, I was in charge of the 8th and the 9th United States Army Air Force. There was, in Europe, the 12th and the 15th. That was a different department. And I was in charge of General Doolittle, Jimmy Doolittle, whom I have met, meanwhile, many a number of times, of the 8th and the 9th. And I was completely at home in mentally in England, in their different stations where they were. The most famous one was the 4th Fighter Group, then the 56th, and so on. And 33 of them I had to have in my mind, and all their officers commanding them. And the three generals of the three fighter wings, the 65th, 66th, and 67th was General Orton, General Anderson, and General Woodbury. I have met after the war over here. Now then, these young men, they were usually between 20 and 25, shot down, had a bad time, because first of all, they were lectured by their intelligence officers in England that they were going to have a rough time with those brutal German tin gods of the Third Reich. Well, they were very surprised when I invited them to sit down to have a West Point cigarette. We had special cigarettes made by the Kentucky Tobacco Company called West Point. And every prisoner was very surprised. That's the way it started when I said, have a West Point cigarette. A West Point cigarette? You got West Point cigarette? Already, rank name and number was forgotten. And these young men were treated like a gentleman. I was brought up in a well-to-do German family where I learned in my youth how to guide a blind man across the street. The principle of my family was that the stronger man should help the weaker one, not vice versa, as it often is in this world. And I figured that the prisoner was the weaker one and I was the stronger one. I had everything at my command. I could make his life miserable, I could make his life more pleasant. And I knew very well that an American officer didn't sell out his country for an extra slice of bread or an extra blanket for his God if it was a cold night. I knew that very well, and I gave it freely to them, which they appreciated. I took them for walks in the beautiful German woods, and there a well-educated American boy isn't numb. He talks, and if it is about the bird singing in the bush or the beautiful trees or anything, but the rank, name, and number business was soon forgotten. The next thing which helped me very much was the department called BUNA, Beauty, News Out of Booty. Well, many plane was down, many B-17 was bellied into Germany. There, our technical groups jumped in and scanned that plane and brought out every little scrap of paper they left in there. The last meal ticket gave us indications. As a matter of fact, General Doolittle asked me, and he said, what helped you most during the war on your side? And I said, the escape photographs. Every American soldier was required, being on enemy mission, to carry 5 photographs, passport photographs, in civilian clothes. And when that order came through, the station photographer in England of the American fighter stations photographed all the men in the same suit, the same tie, and the same shirt. And we had a guy, Sergeant Nagel, he's now professor at the University of California in Irvine, who figured out all the ties and the shirts. And when I had a photograph like that, I would say, what does that tie belong to? Or he'd say, that's the 4th Fighter Group in Depton. Or whatever. And I could say to a prisoner, well, how's good old Depton? He said, how do you know I come from Depton? I could see by his tie, but I didn't tell him. That is the way, as an example, how the information through booty worked. We confiscated everything what was GI, general issue, but private property we returned to the prisoners when they were shipped to permanent prisoner of war camp. For instance, Gabby Gabreski, America's top fighter ace, with whom I still meet from almost every year, As a matter of fact, a couple of years ago, he attended my 75th birthday and flew in from New York to Los Angeles. He was so surprised when I returned to him his private property. His bride, Kay Cochran, had given him a golden wristwatch. And when I opened the manila envelope with his number on it and said, "You are being shipped out, you're going on transport, here's all your private property back," he said, "Oh, my wristwatch." And I said, "Of course, it's your property. We can take that. If it was general issue, we confiscate it. That's war booty. But private property, we don't touch." So when I came to the United States in 1948, I spent my first Christmas night in his home. And I said to him, "Gabby, where's your golden watch?" He said, "The Russians took it when they liberated us." I had, to show you another department, a good chance to break down such a fine fighter. Colonel Gabreski was written up in the Stars and Stripes as soon as he was lost. He was lost for 7 days. He tried to hide in Germany until he was found by some peasants and delivered to us. The German newspapers brought articles. "America's top fighter ace is down." Stars and Stripes printed a story and said, "Colonel Francis, middle initial E, Gabreski, is lost." Stars and Stripes. I was a permanent subscriber to Stars and Stripes. We had a press clipping department, that's the other tool I used, which scanned every American paper and cut it out and gave me whatever I needed. And American newspapers were available through Spain and Portugal. So I like Terry and the Pirates. there was the notice, "Francis E. Gabreski is missing." I pulled out the paper and said, when he was brought to my office, "Colonel Gabreski, I wished you would have been the famous ace." He said, "What do you mean?" "You sign yourself in Francis S. Stanley Gabreski, and Stars and Stripes talks about Francis E. Gabreski. The newspapers make sometimes mistakes, and they helped me. They helped the enemy." And I said, "I am talking about Francis E. Gabreski, who is lost, and he's the famous fighter ace with 28 victories. And you are Francis Stanley." He said, "Come on, cut it out. I'm the famous ace." Rank, name, and number was forgotten. He wasn't a traitor. He was a very fine combat soldier and a very fine gentleman. And, but there was amongst those 50,000 people we processed through the intelligence center, one traitor, a young lieutenant who had stolen a P-38 fighter plane, flew it over to our lines and said, I am convinced that Bolshevism is a mess to the world. I want to fight the Bolsheviks. Here I am. Take me." Well, I was speaking at the grand jury in Brooklyn when he was sentenced to 25 years imprisonment as a traitor because he had flown over to our lines. Times changed. He was maybe ahead of his times, which is hindsight. But and you never know nowadays what a traitor or what a hero is. I mean, I have heard of people going over to the enemy talking on their radio and they become heroes. He got 25 years. Martin Mundy. And that was one of the reasons why I came to the United States. I also was asked by the Pentagon to lecture what my achievements were and how I did it. Well, I'm often asked, what was it worth? What did you do? Give me an example. I like to tell how intelligence works. I got the question, and there are standard questions for identification. So and so many, you have to go through routine. This is bureaucracy. And then there are so-called open questions which come from 101 end, from the high command, from this fighter unit, German. What does that mean? What does the enemy intend to do? Can you answer? And I will find out. One day, I received the question, which is a good example. Our fighter boys have observed in dogfights and in air combat that the American fighters are shooting 10 white tracer bullets in succession. What does it mean? But we don't understand. We don't know. So it is my job now to take the next prisoner and twist his arm and say, what does it mean if there are 10 white tracer bullets shot? It doesn't work that way. One guy, the story is in the book, and if you read it, how he made a slip of the tongue and said, oh, come on, America does never run out of chemicals. We shoot 10 white tracer bullets to show us that we are out of ammunition. What? I immediately wrote a report, and an interrogation officer has to be a skillful writer, because the people who read what you have learned must understand the significance of it. And I immediately wrote a report, disseminated it to all the German fighter stations, and I said, if you are involved in a dogfight, air combat, and you see 10 white tracer bullets, you have a sure kill, because he's out of ammunition. One day, I lectured to German commodores. Amongst them, one of the great fighter aces, Pip Preller, commandant of the 27th German Fighter Group. And when I lectured, I said, gentlemen, I have a very fine American West Point officer, a colonel, sitting in the cooler. If you want to join me for tea, come and meet him. Then you can really meet an enemy. And they say, oh, marvelous. Let's have tea together with Colonel Stark from West Point. Well, during these fighter boys, I like these men with the dark glasses and the big watches. They are much more interesting. They fly all over your room. The bombers, I hope there isn't a bomber here. They are really the bus drivers of the air. The fighters, they are the playboys of the air. And so I went to Germans too. So I had a tea party and a German colonel, Commodore, and they were flying all over my room, and I said, oh, by the way, Scharff, the other day, I was involved in a dogfight with one of those P-51s, and we were shooting at each other. His expression was, out of all buttonholes, and what a fight it was. And you know, suddenly I see this guy shooting at me with 10 white tracer bullets. And that moment I thought of a report you had written. And I said, yes, of course, I know. Did you get another victory? And he said, no, are you crazy? I let him go home. He was out of ammunition, don't you know? That's the way intelligence works. Let me see what the next department is. Yes, we had a department called the Squadron Histories, and there were very fine files printed like the bureaucrats do, United States Army Air Force, 8th Air Force, Fighter Group, Fighter Squadron, everything printed beautifully, and the three fighter wings were arranged in green files, yellow files, blue files, 33 of them. And I had in my office a working table, something like this, and I had these very secret files. I had to sign in and sign out. all laid out nicely on my working table one night. And I got a call from our commandant, and he said, "Scharff, we got so many people, I need room in the cooler. Get these people going out. They go work overtime, I don't care." So in the night, I started working on some POWs. I called the cooler and said, "Bring over another prisoner assigned to me, a fighter." And in came a young lieutenant. He saluted me. We usually exchanged courtesies. And first of all, he went to my working table, and the moment he entered my door of the office, I said, "Oh my God, all the secret files are lying openly, nicely spread out on my working table. I forgot to put them away." But this guy worked over and looked through all the American organization, picked out his file, came to my desk and said, "Reporting signal sent," and handed me his file. He thought that was the procedure. Well, I learned my lesson. From then on, I left them lying there, and whenever a prisoner came in, I said, "Go look for your file." Squadron histories. As a matter of fact, when I showed one of the top aces, General Johnson, now a general, his story, his life story in my file, when he didn't want to tell me anything of the 56th Fighter Group, he thumbed through the whole file and threw it down and said, "This breaks my heart." I knew his mother's maiden name. Then we had a so-called Y department, the listening in boys, English-speaking German soldiers who were sitting there with radio and writing down every word what was spoken in the air 24 hours. That produced a volume every day this thick, like the Chicago telephone book. And I had to read through this. Sometimes I just thumbed through. Every word spoken by the enemy, from ground to air, from plane to plane, from plane to ground, was recorded in English, brought to my desk, and I could read through it. Of course, then I knew all the frequencies. I knew which frequency belonged to what secret call sign. And an American would never tell me his secret call sign until we captured the command car with a new code, which the Americans didn't even know yet. But the new words they were getting, I had it already. And one day, I thumbed through the what was called the situation of the air, and I saw strange remarks, very, very rough soldiers' language. Forgive me, ladies, for quoting these guys. What happened? A fighter group comes flying in low over Germany, and right in front flies White One, the group leader, and way back, the last one is Purple Heart Corner, Blue Four. And in my book, it says, "White One to Blue Four. Steady boy, steady boy, there's nothing to worry about." And then comes back the answer, "Blue Four to White One." "No, I won't say it exactly. You can steady my fanny," he said. And he bailed out. What happened was that the group leader in front saw two 109s coming in. And of course, they always get the last one, Purple Heart Corner. And they shut him down, he bailed out. But before he bailed out, he called back his colonel and he said, "You steady my fanny." And out he went, and he came to my office. And I said, "Hey, you, the way you talk to your colonel, that's no way to talk to a superior officer." And I showed him my book, and he said, "Yeah, I know, my God, you got that in printing." That worried him. There was a very famous voice calling the secret calls signed Sweepstake 2. And these German boys, the Y boys, they heard every day directions from call sign with a very deep voice, Sweepstake 2, Sweepstake 2, Sweepstake 2. One day we caught Captain Silverman, Sweepstake 2. We caught him. And I said, I'll take you up to our listening in tower, way up on the mountain where these guys are listening in. And without telling them who I was bringing as a guest, it was just an American captain. I introduced the bunch of them and I said, this is Shorty and this is Blackie and so and so and so and so, the Germans. And he said to each one of them, shaking hands, how do you do? How do you do? How do you do? This, that's Sweepstake too. And it was. And he said, come on, listen into the radio and find out who your successor is. And the odd thing occurred right in the middle of the war that the secret enemy listens into his own station on the other side. Imagine. We had a fabulous photo lab. I could do anything I wanted in blowing up pictures, and I looked at many, many a combat film, because I'm sure you understand that whenever a gun was fired, a movie was taking the pictures of the shots. And when a plane was downed, we looked at the shootings. If you do read The Interrogator, you will find a very dramatic story of seven accused American fighter men I had to defend, who were accused of having shot into the city of Greifswald and killed many civilians. I did have pictures. I delivered them at the Pentagon, where flyers shot peasant women on the field and hunted them like hares, school children on bicycles. But I have never caught one who committed such acts. Some of them, where I had the films, were killed. But I had seven to defend who were accused of that. And the German propaganda ministry was very keen on showing the German public that they were, as they propagandized all the time, that they were air gangsters. Well, it was a very dramatic story that I found that they were not guilty, released them to the prisoner of war camp, they were returned to me, and I had to re-interrogate these guys, this time in the presence of one of those nasty Gestapo guys, as they are described all the time. Not all the Gestapo guys were nasty, but this one was. He was at my side, I re-interrogated them, and it almost led to a debacle. However, I wrote a long brief in proving that they were involved in the raid, but they personally were not responsible for the killings, and this went right up to Hermann Göring, and one night, 3 o'clock in the morning, I was awakened, and he said, the Reichsmarschall just has given word through that your seven prisoners of Greifswald are to be freed if they are bona fide combat soldiers. And they were. Well, the leader of this group, of the seven, First Lieutenant Weisel, called me from Bakersfield after 33 and a half years by accident. And they knew that they were looking down a barrel. The photo lab helped me once in developing a film, and there was one. I also was in charge of the PRU squadrons, the photo reconnaissance planes, which were unarmed and flew way up photographing our stations, especially in France. Well, I caught one who had made a couple of test shots with his camera before he left England, and what he shot was his own air base. And we developed that, and I had a beautiful picture of Mount Farm, which was the place General Roosevelt, the son of President Roosevelt, commanded. I had a beautiful picture of Mount Farm, and there all the ships were lined up, Spitfires as well as P-51s, in a semi-circle, and in the middle of the circle was a man working on the jeep, and then all the hangars, and right in front was a P-38 with a number clearly readable, lined up, and I had that picture blown up as big as my desk. And one time the first Lieutenant Prokop came in, and I knew such a lot about Mount Farm, I didn't have to question him, but I wanted to play a little foolish joke with him. And I put that photograph upside down on my table, and I said, Lieutenant, you can go. I know all about you and about Mount Farm. You don't have to tell me any, one question. And I turned over the photograph and I said, what is this guy doing on the jeep there? Ridiculous question. But he looked through the cunning way I was trying to fool him, because the first ship right in front with the number on it, that was his. And he thought every prisoner is presented with a big photograph of myself fooling around. Well, then another way of fooling around with prisoners was asking them how many states there were in the United States. Big question. Well, any child knows that at that time, of course, 48. And then we would give them a pencil and a paper and say, write down those 48 states. And of course, in Europe, with those little countries, you know every state and every county, but the United States are so big, we knew that most of the guys would get stuck at 35, 36 and chew the pencil and say, can't get together 48 states. And he would say, you claim to be an American, you can't even account for 48 states. You're not an American. What are you talking about? One day, my assistant, Bill Engelhardt, came to me and said, Hanns, I found my master. I said, what do you mean? I have a man, an American captain, sitting 28 days in the cooler. That was the longest time we were permitted by the Geneva Convention. The United States did the very same thing. They didn't hold a man longer than 28 days. And the only one I know from this end was a U-boat captain who stuck it out 28 days without saying anything. Well, Bill Engelhardt, my assistant, came to me and he said, I found my master. I have a man sitting in the pool 28 days and I don't even know the squadron he belongs to. If I knew that, I could let him go. But no way, he could be a spy, he could be anything. I said, Bill, if he is such a tough guy, and such a fine man, pay him your respects. He's the better one than you are. And you have to pay him your... As a matter of fact, I have a little party tonight, some beer drinking, sing-song party. Bring him along and we pay him our respects. Well, in comes Captain Mozart Kaufmann. Mozart is a funny first name for any German. We are called Hanns and Franz and Fritz and Karl, but not Mozart. Mozart Kaufmann. And I received him and I said, participate in my little gathering here. We are just friendly, drink some beer. Tomorrow you are on transport, I promise you. No more questioning, interrogation is through, and you are a very fine officer. So, in fooling around on that evening, I can think of nothing better but that silly, stupid joke with the 48 states. And I said to him, oh, Mozart, by the way, one more question, please. How many states in the United States? And he said, you know, before I answer such a stupid question, I'd rather sign your guest book. He saw my guest book lying on the table and had some thumbed through it. But what he wrote into the guest book, and you can see it at the Air Force Museum, was, Hanns, you are slick and sly. I wasn't. I tried to be nice. You are slick and sly, but you make a very good party companion. Yours, Captain Mozart Kaufmann, 48 Fighter Group. I called him the other day. Great Oliver called me after 35 years, and he said, Hanns, you know something? This is more a personal story. I found the address of Mozart Kaufmann. He is living in San Anselmo. I said, where's San Anselmo? In North California. I took out my road map and I looked up San Anselmo. It's north of San Francisco. And right next to it is a little city called Larkspur. And that's connected by a road which is called Sir Francis Drake Drive. So I get onto the telephone and say, Ray Tolliver had given me his address but not his telephone number. Information, do you have a Mozart Kaufmann in San Anselmo? And the telephone information was very good. He said to me, no, I don't have a Mozart Kaufmann in San Anselmo, but I have one in Larkspur, which is right next door. And I said, oh, that must be the same. Give me. Did you make the connection? And boom, right there was Mozart. And I said, this is Hanns Scharff. And he said, Hanns, you beat me to it. I was going to say, you must be Hanns Scharff when you called me. Your telephone ring. We had a beautiful conversation. Said, remember the time? Oh, sure. And we talked. And I said, how are you doing? And he said, fine. I have a business. And the devil was riding me. I just said, is it on Sir Francis Drake's Drive? And he said, yes. How do you know? You have a file on me. He's convinced I still check on him. Now, we had, of course, we allowed prisoners to write postcards home. And Colonel Stark, the West Pointer, who knew the Army manual very well, of course, came into my office, and he was an oddity. He was from the 12th. And I got lots of odd cases to handle. And I was to take care of Colonel Stark. And he, as a West Pointer, said immediately to me, what's your rank? I said, private first class. He said, but the manual and the Geneva Convention says that a prisoner of a certain rank has to be interrogated by the same rank or one rank higher. And you are a private? Yeah, I'm a full colonel. And I said, okay, you want to be interrogated by a general? And I went to my closet and he said, forget it. I was going to put on a general's uniform, just for him. And then he wrote, being a very intelligent man, a postcard, tried to deceive us, and wrote to his commanding general, Seville, of the 12th Air Force in Africa. He said, General, sir, the Germans have a blood and urine test on every one of us. I'm glad to know that your cold is better. And General Seville was very mad with him after the war. And yet, what did he try to do? He tried to inform through us, through our camp, his own outfit, that we had an enormous amount of knowledge. I think I have to come to the close because the time is getting short. I quickly want to tell you, talking about odd cases, that I was commanded to interrogate a British bomber. Of all people, I didn't know anything about it. But he was such an odd case. He flew a Lancaster 3, the biggest plane they could deliver, a 500-pound bomb at a very long distance. And he was to have flown over England a petrol test. And his ship was loaded with cement sacks. His navigator wasn't the best of navigators. He landed in Czechoslovakia, in Eger, at a German air base. And the German sergeant was once a smart one, shot green, land, he put his gear out, rolled in, and the Germans jumped his plane, German Luftwaffe soldiers, and shouted at the captain, "Hendo, hands up!" And he said, "My God, the bloody Germans are already in Sussex." We couldn't handle the big bird, so we asked him to please taxi it into one of our hangars. And he politely did, good old sport he was. One more thing. We had nothing to do with the East. Our outfit was called Evaluation Center and Interrogation Center West, Foreign Air Forces West. There was also an outfit East which was dealing with the Russians. We had nothing to do with Russians. But we had about 20 Russian soldiers as handymen who would grow a vegetable garden and who would light our stoves in the offices and clean them out as workmen. And these Russians were allowed to take a shower once a week on Saturday afternoon. Well, the whole city of the little village of Oberursel knew always when it was Saturday afternoon when they heard the Russians taking a shower, because you can't imagine what raucous they started in shouting and slapping each other and whistling and screaming. Unbelievable. And that shower was in the basement of the cooler. One Saturday afternoon, the guardhouse called me and he said, "Scharff, there is an American lieutenant, a fighter, sitting in the cooler and he wishes to be immediately interrogated." I said, "Yeah, send him over." He came in white in his face and he said, "Sir, I'm going to tell you anything you want. I can't stand that brutality going on in the basement." Now, if you will, you can ask me questions, but before I conclude, I would like to tell you my favorite story. I had become very well known amongst the higher circles of the High Command in Berlin. And one night, by reports I had written, and one night the commandant called me and he said, "Scharff, we are going to be inspected by General Field Marshal Gabo Schmidt. He's coming in tonight to inspect us. And please be at your desk and work, because he is going around to see the whole camp." So that was my order. I was at 8 o'clock at my desk, and suddenly a big crowd of high-ranking officers are shuffling down the corridor. They had to tense the field marshal himself, of course, and the commandant stuck the head through my door and she said, "Ah, Scharff, are you still at work?" I was honored to do so. He told me. And I said, "Yes, sir, still working." And in is ushered His Excellency with all his staff and a lot of fruit salad and brass and red stripes and white stripes. And my office wasn't big enough. They were sitting at my working table around. And he said, I have read your reports. Now, I want to know how you do that. I want to know it. And I said, Your Excellency, I have, show me. He said, show me. Go on, show me. I said, Your Excellency, I have three different categories. I have American fighter boys who came in today. I haven't even seen yet. I don't know who they are. I have some I talk to. I go for a walk in the woods. I have some which are going out on transport. Which one of those categories, which one would you like me to interrogate? He said, start from the bottom, right from the beginning. Take a man you have not seen before. So I called the guardhouse and I said, bring over Lieutenant Jones. But after a short while, a young American fighter lieutenant walks into my room and sees all that brass and fruits. And I got up from my desk and I said, I'm your interrogation officer. Sit down, take it easy. Have a cigarette and so on. And don't worry about all these guys sitting around here. You have to tell me some questions. Well, here comes the old game. Rank, name, and number. Rank, name, and number. It's getting very boring. I said, you have to tell me more. I don't believe it. All my tricks didn't work. Rank, name, and number. 20 minutes. Getting very boring. I can notice it on the faces of the others. And suddenly this young man gets up from the chair. He was sitting in front of my desk, goes over to my window, stands at ease, and starts telling me all kinds of questions. Where are you from? What ammunition have you been carrying? What have you been attacking? What was your mission? One question after another. Fantastic. And I said to Schmidt, Your Excellency, as you can see, I am in good conversation with my prisoner, and I would think it is much better if I continue my conversation alone. And he said, oh, I see, you want to throw me out. I said, yes, Your Excellency. And he said, why isn't this man decorated yet? Does he drink too much schnapps? And out he went. As soon as that whole bunch of officers had left my room and the door was closed, this young American kid came over to me, laid his hand on my shoulder and said, did I help you out of a mess you were in?